And the last speaker for this session is Dr. Dominic Angelillo from University of Florida in Jacksonville, and he's going to discuss optimizing antiplatelet therapy in patients with diabetes mellitus. Please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Pleasure to be here. I want to start off by thanking the... do I need to pull up here? I cannot find my presentation. Okay, it's coming up. Yes, it's coming up. Here we go. We'd like to start with thanking the Israel Heart Society for this kind invite, as well as the ACC for inviting me to be part of this joint session. Now, I know we're a little bit late, and this is actually the time of the coffee break, so I'll try to go a little bit quicker so there'll still be coffee left outside. The scope of my presentation is to present to you an ongoing topic, which is that on optimizing antiplatelet therapy in patients with diabetes. And I will be showing you some of the data going from bench to bedside. A lot of the research in this field does derive from translational investigations. These are my disclosures. So let's start off with why this is important. As you can see, this is an analysis coming from the TIMI group, looking at 11 TIMI trials. And what you can see consistently from this slide, that irrespective of the clinical presentation of ACS patients, either unstable angina, non-STEMI or STEMI, patients with diabetes do have higher mortality. This is shown as early as 30 days and persists out up to 1 year. And the other fact to keep in mind is that the prevalence of diabetes is continuing to increase. As you can see, over the next couple of decades, there will be a doubling of the prevalence of diabetes. So if on one hand that means job security, obviously, for the cardiovascular specialist, on the other also means how to deal with this high-risk patient population. Now, one of the aspects that characterizes patients with diabetes, as you all know, is this prothrombotic status. I'm not going to go into details of this slide, but this clearly highlights how there are multiple mechanisms associated with this prothrombotic status, underscoring how complex this treating these patients can be. Now, the importance of tailoring antiplatelet therapy, tailoring the hyperreactive diabetic platelet, comes from many studies. Some of these, for example, with the 2B3 inhibitors. This is a meta-analysis coming from Marco Rolfi, which clearly indicates that when we're using these potent therapies, we can significantly reduce ischemic events, in particular mortality, amongst those patients undergoing PCI. Nevertheless, we do not rely on these intravenous agents for secondary prevention of our patients, and this leads us to go ahead and analyze what are the outcomes of what we can do with regards to oral therapies. This is an analysis coming from the antiplatelet trialist collaboration, and what you can see here is that irrespective of diabetic status, there is a benefit with oral antiplatelet therapy, and this is mostly associated with aspirin. But what you can also see is that among those patients with diabetes treated with oral antiplatelet therapy, the risk of having an ischemic recurrence is higher than those patients without diabetes, even on treatment, without treatment. One of the mechanisms that we believe is that it's not that aspirin is not working in these patients. It's simply that these patients persist with what we call a hyperreactive platelet phenotype. In other words, aspirin is doing its job on blocking the COX-1 enzyme, but you can see here when we use tests looking at non-COX-1 specific signaling, there's always increased platelet reactivity. Now, the other aspect to keep in mind is that the vast majority of our patients nowadays are treated with dual antiplatelet therapy. And here you see the data from the CURE trial. And what we've learned from the CURE trial is that that clopidogrel, although beneficial amongst patients with diabetes, the prevalence of events is nearly the double compared to patients without diabetes. And this may also be in line with some of the more recent data, for example, looking at stent thrombosis rates with drug-eluting stents. And in all the analysis that we've seen over the course of the past several years, diabetes always pops up as an independent predictor of stent thrombosis. And so again, we go back to the bench. You know, what are the mechanisms? Is there a differential response to oral antiplatelet therapy, in this specific case to clopidogrel, among patients with diabetes? And here you see a series of studies conducted in the acute phase of treatment and the long-term phase of treatment. No matter how you dice the data and whatever cutoff you use, patients with diabetes persist with a hyperreactive platelet phenotype. And here you see some elegant studies coming from our Swedish colleagues trying to understand why this happens. This is an analysis looking at the novel agent prasugrel as well. And one of the mechanisms, as you can see here, is simply that there's lower circulating levels of the active metabolite, suggesting that there can be a problem with absorption or even metabolism amongst patients with diabetes. Another mechanism is simply that we have upregulation of the signaling pathway at the platelet level. This again is an in vitro study, and you can see when using very high concentrations of the active metabolite clopidogrel, we can continue to see that there is an upregulation of the pathway, or better off, a dysfunction of the pathway itself. So another concept that has also emerged, and this also comes going back to the bedside and what we see in our clinical practice, is that not all patients with diabetes are actually the same. We do know that there are some patients who do perfectly fine, but others just come back over and over and over again with ischemic recurrences. So the question is why, and can platelets continue to have a role in this process? And in our opinion, the answer is yes. We've spoken previously about the concept of variability in response and how diabetes can be a predictor. But even when we look within the diabetic patient population, we can see differences in response to treatment. And as you can see here, those who have a specific level of platelet reactivity above a certain threshold do have a higher risk of ischemic recurrences out up to 2 years. And so the question is, why? Why do certain diabetes in our clinical practice do worse than others? And you can say they may be all be having the same degree of treatment, same level of glucose control, and maybe the problem may reside in genetics. This is one of the studies looking to this concept, in which looking at genetic profiling for the insulin receptor substrate, which is also located on the platelet, and which we know modulates the effects of insulin and also platelet reactivity. You can see that there are certain genotypes that can be associated with a hyperreactive platelet phenotype and also be associated with worse clinical outcomes. So the second part of my talk will be focusing at this point. We know that there's a problem. At this point, you know, what do we do to optimize antiplatelet therapy in these patients? And here I put the three strategies that I do believe are available. First is playing smarter with what we have. Two, adding an additional antiplatelet agent. And third, using new therapies. We'll start off with the first bullet point, playing smarter with what we have. You can see here from this cartoon, oxidative stress has a key role in hyperreactive platelets, therefore leading to increased turnover. And so glucose control definitely has a key role in these patients to reduce the level of oxidative stress. So you can see here that one simple way, and therefore using what we have, is either reducing oxidative stress or giving aspirin, for example, sample twice daily to overcome the increased turnover. And the concept of reducing oxidative stress is actually an old concept. You see here, this is an article from the New England Journal of Medicine from Carlo Patrono's group in 1990. And you can see that amongst those patients who have a better metabolic control with insulin treatment, you also have a reduction in urinary thromboxane, something which is not achieved in those patients who in whom better metabolic control is unsuccessful. However, we do know in our clinical practice that this is something that is not always achieved, and therefore another concept that has been recently introduced and reported in several studies is that of giving aspirin twice daily to overcome the concept of this increased release of platelets from the bone marrow, and who are therefore not inhibited by aspirin, which may be taken by the patient early in the morning, and therefore able to generate thromboxane and continue to be associated with increased platelet reactivity. The same concept has also been evaluated for clopidogrel, and this is part of a series of studies called Optimus, or optimizing antiplatelet therapy. The problem is that even when we modify these strategies with what we have, only a certain fraction of our patients actually reach the therapeutic target. So this leads to our second strategy, which is considering additional antiplatelet therapies. And again, we go back to our bench work and try to understand what is going on, what is wrong within these specific diabetic platelets. And we already alluded to the concept of upregulation of P2Y12 receptor signaling, which is associated with reduced levels of cyclic AMP. So there's a dysfunctional status along this pathway. So one of the ways of overcoming this is simply by bypassing this strategy using an agent such as cilostazol, which is an inhibitor of phosphodiesterase 3 and associated with an increase in cyclic AMP. And this led to the design of another strategy of optimizing therapy, Juice Optimus 2. And again, without going into details, yes, this concept of triple therapy using cilostazol is something that can reduce platelet reactivity or achieve greater platelet inhibition. And this may explain what we see in clinical studies, such as the DECLARE diabetes, other studies looking at stent thrombosis, showing better outcomes among patients with diabetes treated with triple therapy compared to a standard dual antiplatelet therapy. But in my opinion, the true answer is with the new drugs. Here you see in this cartoon the results of the three major trials looking at novel strategies, Tritan-TIMI-38 with prasugrel, Plato with ticagrelor, and the CARNOASIS-7 with high-dose clopidogrel. And what you can see from this analysis is that clearly with prasugrel, there is an enhanced benefit amongst patients with diabetes. We see a benefit also amongst patients treated with ticagrelor with outcomes which are consistent with the overall trial results. Here you see the analysis from the diabetic subgroup. Again, a 30% relative risk reduction with a number needed to treat of 21 without any differences in major bleeding compared with clopidogrel, and with a benefit, as you can see here, which is proportional to the risk of the patient. So again, something that we've seen in earlier trials, even with 2B3 inhibitors, that higher the risk of the patient, greater the benefit of a more potent platelet inhibiting strategy. And again, this goes in line with what we've seen in the research lab, that patients with insulin-dependent diabetes also have higher levels of platelet reactivity. And again, when we look from a functional standpoint, this is the Optimus 3. Again, looking at prasugrel versus high-dose clopidogrel, definitely an enhanced benefit. What do we know about ticagrelor? Again, as mentioned before, consistent effects with regards to the overall trial. But what was quite interesting is that poor glycemic control, greater the benefits of these patients because, again, as mentioned before, poor glycemic control means increased oxidative stress, and you see here without any differences in bleeding, although we know that patients with diabetes are highest also higher risk for bleeding. Now, just to wrap up, and as promised, I was trying to go a little bit quicker. We focused most of the past 20 years of clinical investigation in the field by blocking two key pathways, COX-1 with aspirin and P2Y12 with clopidogrel and the novel agents. But as you can see here, there are many unblocked receptors on the platelet surface. And some of these may be exposed, for example, specifically in patients with diabetes to higher levels of thrombin, and therefore leading to escape mechanism of thromboxane generation, and therefore highlighting the need for alternative strategies to block platelet aggregation. Many of these are on the way, such as thromboxane inhibitors, PAR1 receptor antagonists, and even the novel oral anticoagulants. And to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, I've focused a lot on differences in treatments, newer strategies, and genetics. I also like to highlight that we should not lose in mind that we need to keep in mind that we are physicians and never forget the ABCs of our patient treatment of our patients with diabetes. A, reduce hemoglobin A1C levels. B, blood pressure. C, cholesterol. As all of these are associated with reduced platelet reactivity. Thank you very much for your attention.